after you pursue, search for, chase after happiness in a million places, life teaches you, doesn't it, to settle on a certain degree of happiness that comes and goes. Who has ever had a life of uninterrupted happiness? Some gifts we think will make us happiest have been known to end up in the garage sale next spring. I've never been there, but I'm told that when touring his home near Defiance, Missouri, you'll learn how frontiersman Daniel Boone, for whom, by the way, happiness was a good gun, a good horse, and a good wife, built his own coffin and did from time to time get into it to see if he still fit. Maybe it was his way to be convinced of his fitness to be immortal, or at least how others would one day follow in his tracks. What gives you happiness? Where is your happiness? Mine is music, wife and grandchildren, pretty natural. The time of serving our congregation and being encouraged by your faith. Mowing the lawn. Frank, don't we still have the sign-up sheet in the hallway for people to sign up if they want me to mow their lawn? Sermon today isn't about any of those things or happy thoughts in general, but is centered again on the one to whom John the Baptist pointed, the one Jesus, who was not fit for a coffin. He was sinless and did nothing deserving death. The one who came into the world to take our sins to the grave. But he rose from that grave and now lives to give the treasures of his grace to enrich us and fit us to be his faithful people, called to live lives of faith that rejoice, pray, and give thanks in all circumstances, with or without COVID. Have you found yourself rejoicing, praying, and giving thanks more than you ever have in your life? In all circumstances, Paul means to say, whether in the prime of life or perfect health or bedridden or facing the coffin, we live in him who will come again to gladden and make happy every true believer. Yes, the church is wise in the choice of today's epistle. It fits here in the middle of Advent. Every chapter of Paul's first letter to 1 Thessalonians closes with the mention of our Lord's coming. Chapter 1 ends, "Wait for his Son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, Jesus, who rescues us from the coming wrath." Chapter 2, "What is our hope, our joy, or the crown in which we will glory in the presence of our Lord Jesus Christ when he comes?" Chapter 3, may he strengthen your hearts so that you will be blameless and holy in the presence of God and Father when our Lord Jesus comes with his holy ones. The close of chapter 4 speaks of the Lord's return with a loud command, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet call of God. And today, the end of chapter 5, our epistle reading, "May your whole spirit, soul, and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ." For sure, Advent is about preparation for Christ's coming. And it is about happiness. The third Sunday in Advent takes the name "Rejoice." Happiness in the midst of our waiting. happiness marked by this rose-colored day. That's not to say we always go around looking at the world through rose-colored glasses, or successfully perfuming a pig, or simply laughing or toughing it out with a grin on our faces. No one wants to be passed by when happiness is dished out to the children of men. Isn't happiness one of those certain inalienable rights of the Declaration of Independence? What if in a world of hate and despair, feuding and fighting and pain and death, happiness would reign? Is there such a thing as a happy life? Does it seem hidden or a secret? It is a secret in a sense, but not because God wants to keep it a secret. The joy and happiness of God, the God who has delivered through the sending of His Son and Savior, is announced through Isaiah and Paul and John the Baptist. Why is Isaiah happy? He has the promise of freedom, comfort, and salvation. John gives us a look back to Isaiah, who prophesied the one, Jesus, to come. Happiness is on the lips and face of Paul as he directs us to the secret of happiness. Don't misunderstand. Paul didn't bring this up. This is our Heavenly Father's heart, the secret of true happiness only His Holy Spirit can reveal. It comes through in two of the shortest verses of the Bible. Rejoice always. Pray without ceasing. Standing alone, these words may mean little more to you than magnets on the refrigerator door. However, these two short verses fixed on the gospel and the person of Jesus Christ become the reliable prescription for a life of happiness. Rejoice evermore is more than keep smiling. Why can you and I rejoice? Why can we not be afraid of death and happily hope for heaven? Because of what's wrapped under the Christmas tree? No, but only because of the love of God that is ours daily with His strength and His assurance. Can we be brought back into God's favor after we've made Him unhappy with our sins? Can we be reconciled with our Creator after a life of shameful, careless living? Yes, Paul says, in the name of the God of peace. God made peace. His love is for us. Rejoice evermore. Sin is our unhappiness. But God, who is rich in mercy, provides full and free forgiveness through the redeeming blood of His Son. That's the foundation for true happiness all the days of your life, every day until our Lord comes again. And what about all the days of your life? Does the love of God mean you will not suffer tribulation and trials and sickness and all the woes? No, but it does mean you will not suffer as those who have no hope, comfort, or joy. We are, Paul says, growing up, being sanctified completely, that is, made holy, growing up to maturity in Christ through whom the Father is working to heal and unify. That's right, between our being called, gathered, enlightened, and sanctified, between our coming to faith and our Lord's coming again, we give evidence of true happiness that is not fickle or froth, but certain and firm. There's no question in my mind that the Thessalonians had as much trouble and challenge as rejoicing, praying, and giving thanks as we do. But Paul's words were kind words of encouragement. Not the sharp sting of rebuke, a reminder to remember. Remember, that's a special word for believers. Most of us think that remembering is the opposite of forgetting. It isn't. I'd have to think of the opposite of remembering as dismembering, cutting off. Remembering is reconnecting. Prayer remembers you to the God whom you know in Jesus. Rejoicing is remembering you to the Lord who has been your help in ages past, who will be your hope tomorrow, and who will be alive and at the center of your worship in heaven. At the altar, you are remembered with the entire church on earth and in heaven and with Jesus himself, because his word is packed with promise as you eat and drink the bread and wine in remembrance of him. We need remembered, because the world is and has always been a dangerous, not always a happy place. We are blessed to know God who has brought us to a new day to breathe and walk and abound with his grace. But we still get sick and we pray for the sick. We still hurt one another. We still die. And still that voice cries out in the wilderness. And people like Paul remind us to remember who we are, whose we are, and the one to whom we fix our eyes, the one Jesus who comes to deliver. Remember and redefine happiness. Rejoice. Amen. The peace of God that passes all understanding, keep your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus.